Good evening. My name is Dr. Nina Ahmad, and I will be your moderator for this series on COVID-19 by the American Academy of Family Physicians. We will be hosting this series on Friday nights at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. Each week, we will have a brief status update and a guest speaker. You can ask our speakers questions before and after each session through the COVID-19 Rapid Response Member Exchange message board. You can also ask questions during the live chat feature during this session. Speakers will try their best to answer as many questions as they can. These sessions will be recorded live so you can review them later on. You can always refer to them whenever you need to. The sessions are going to be put together based on your feedback, so please feel free to give as many comments as you'd like, and we try to rearrange the sessions to be best fitting what your needs are. Now here we're going to look at some housekeeping efforts. So this is a session that's approved for 1 AFP prescribed credits, and it's an enduring credit, so you can always go back to it. And it's a T2P activity where you can get 2 additional credits. I have nothing to disclose, and here are our learning objectives. So for today's session, I'm going to do a quick situational summary and a little bit of background literature to go through before we go into Dr. Laura Jordhen's experience in China to give some perspective. The first slide, it's very difficult when you look at a lot of numbers to figure out what's going on. So I thought this was a good representation. It was somewhat of a snapshot to look at what's going on in the different countries and where we're at. You can see the curve for the United States and Italy. In red, you can see China and South Korea, where they're somewhat flattening at this point. There are some limitations to looking at data like this, like the limited testing in certain countries. So you have to use it as a snapshot to try to figure out where we're going. Here you can see the distribution of reported cases in the United States and the total cases, which is 239,279 cases, and total deaths 5,443 as of today. So this was an interesting correspondence to the editor, and I think it helps give some information and perspective of what's going on. Basically, in this study, the first graph you can see, they generated aerosols containing SARS-CoV-2, and they tried to create a aerosolized environment. And during this study, what they found was throughout the whole time that they conducted it, 3 hours, they found viable virus throughout the duration. So the key here was not that it was a study looking at airborne transmission, but it was looking at whether you could find viable virus in an aerosolized generating environment, such as an aerosolized generating procedure. Then if you look on the right side, you can see copper, cardboard, stainless steel, and plastic. And they looked at surface stability, and they found stainless steel and plastic the virus was more stable on, and it actually lasted longer than 72 hours on both stainless steel and plastic. So we're hearing a lot of information about asymptomatic spread, pre-symptomatic spread, symptomatic spread. And I wanted to give you 2 scenarios that were in the literature that gave some unique examples of what was going on. In this example, there was a presumed asymptomatic carrier. And what happened was there was a 20-year-old female in Wuhan who traveled to Anyang. She interacted with 5 of her family members. And then when after a period of time, they ended up getting sick and they had symptoms. They all also had PCR positive tests, and they also had abnormalities on their CAT scans. And on the CAT scans is what we have been seeing lately, which is the multifocal ground glass opacities on the chest CT. And one person had subsegmental areas of consolidation and fibrosis. What's interesting about this scenario is that the woman actually never had symptoms. They did a CAT scan on her twice, and they didn't identify any significant abnormalities for her. So that was unique compared to other asymptomatic transmission reports. Additionally, she was PCR negative on her first test, and then they did another test, and she ended up being PCR positive. So they think that the first test was actually a false negative. This second study was actually done in the United States, and it was an MMWR that recently came out. And this was interesting because they looked at a scenario in a skilled nursing facility in Washington where a healthcare provider came into work while symptomatic and for 2 days. And then seven individuals, residents at the facility, ended up coming out positive. So they looked at 76 individuals at the residence. That was about 93% of the residents there, and assessed them for symptoms and also tested them. And they found that 23 were positive on PCR when they tested them. They categorized them into symptomatic, pre-symptomatic, and asymptomatic categories because they tested them at multiple time points and were able to categorize a pre-symptomatic group. So 10 out of 23 were symptomatic, 10 out of 23 were pre-symptomatic, and 3 ended up being asymptomatic. So what's interesting about this study is most of the residents had low cycling times, which indicates there were large quantities of viral RNA, and there was no significant difference in mean cycling times between each group. So really that's what that saying is, between asymptomatic, pre-symptomatic, and symptomatic individuals, there wasn't a significant difference in how many quantities of viral RNA there was on detection. So this next slide, I tried to compile three articles together to try to be helpful in looking at the symptoms incubation period and some of the issues that come up. So if you look at time point zero at the bottom, that's symptom onset, and you look to the left of the chart, you can see the incubation period. So that's basically when the person's exposed, how many days it takes for them to actually develop symptoms. So they looked at 181 confirmed cases. And from that study, they did some modeling and found the median was 5.1 days, which was consistent with other studies. So basically, when someone got exposed, it took about 5.1 days for them to develop symptoms. The range ended up being around 2 to 11 days to end up showing symptoms. What's interesting here is when they did the modeling, they found that if you used 14 days as a cutoff, you would actually miss 1 out of 100 individuals. So what that means is, if someone got exposed on day zero, and then you use your cutoff to look to see if they ended up having symptoms at day 14, after that, you'd miss out of 100 people. If you look on the right side of the symptom onset, you can see the serology and PCR testing that they did. So all the studies on the right side were done in China, and they also were done in hospitalized patients. So here in the second study, they found IgM was actually better than PCR after 5.5 days of symptom onset in these hospitalized patients. And the combination of PCR with IgM showed a positive detection rate of 98.6%. But if you did PCR alone, it ended up being 51.9%. And then for those who actually developed dyspnea, they found the median time frame was 8 days with a range of 5 to 13 days. And the median time frame for ARDS was 9 days with a range of 8 to 14 days. So why is this all important? I'm sure everybody here knows why this is important, but there's a lot of confusion about it really being about elderly people, and the numbers get kind of confusing as we throw a lot of the numbers around. So I tried to put it in a sort of a framework of more digestible numbers. So you can see little stick figures representing 30 individuals. And in this study, that was an MMWR looking at individuals who outcomes patients with coronavirus disease during February 12th to March 16th. They looked at 2,449 individuals where they knew the age, but they didn't know the outcome of all individuals. So from that, you could glean 9 in 30 were hospitalized, 3 in 30 went to the ICU, and 1 didn't make it. So now looking at it out of 100 and looking at each age range using the same key as yellow, orange, and red, we can see what happens in each age group. ~65 to ~74, ~75 to ~84, and greater than or equal to 85. So I want to leave you, before we go to Dr. Jordhen's talk, with this pictorial, which looked at hospital regions and their bed capacity. And it looked at the percentage of adults who would get infected over different time ranges and what that would look like between 18 months, 12 months, and 6 months. So I hope that gave some perspective before we go into Dr. Laura Jordhen's talk. I'd like to introduce Dr. Laura Jordhen. She is a chief of family medicine at United Family Hospital in Shanghai, China. Prior to her role as chief, she served as infection control chair. We are fortunate to have her speak about her experiences in China during the pandemic. Thank you, Dr. Jordhen.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmad. Thank you for that succinct introduction. That really highlights the challenge of this disease, asymptomatic spread, but potential for serious illness. So welcome. I want to start with a message to all my colleagues in the U.S. That this is an incredibly challenging time, but remember to reach out to your colleagues to connect. Social distance doesn't mean social isolation. I also want to put out the message there that we're used to toughing it out and working sick, but in this day and age, a runny nose, a sniffle, that could be signs of coronavirus, and you don't want to give it to your patients, so don't work sick. This is my hospital, United Family Hospital. This is just after we got our JCI accreditation for the fourth time, maybe in 2017. I was, as Dr. Mod said, the infection control chief at a time when we had a measles outbreak in the international schools. So we had already had a really recent experience with a highly contagious illness and preventing nosocomial spread. We are a multi-hospital network. We are not in Wuhan, but in several other major cities in China. And our first hospital was built back in the 90s. So let me take you back to January. January 4th, we had not heard about the cases in Wuhan of pneumonia that clinically looked like SARS, although that information had already been released to the World Health Organization several days prior. We had a patient come to our hospital with a pneumonia initially of unknown cause. She was a young woman. What was remarkable was she was in her mid-30s, previously well. She arrived with symptoms of sepsis, cough and fever several days prior, diarrhea, and she tested influenza negative the day before. She had traveled to Japan, but no travel to Hubei province or to Wuhan city. She came by private car. We saw her in our clinic. We sent her to our inpatient ward for urgent fluid resuscitation and transferred her out, as we are a smaller hospital, small private hospital, and don't have an intensive care unit. She was intubated, and while staphylococcal pneumonia was ultimately diagnosed at the time she presented, we did not know the cause of her illness, and she was influenza negative. She was fully recovered eventually. Then this happened. January 7th, the sequence for the novel coronavirus was released, the genomic sequence. So this was big news here. So we looked back at that case from January 8th. So by this time, the US CDC had alerted clinicians to beware of patients with respiratory symptoms if they had traveled from Wuhan. And we looked back at that January 4th case. What if this was an emerging pathogen? How might we have handled it differently? So we worked on our protocol to rapidly identify and isolate any suspicious patients, to keep them in our negative pressure rooms in the emergency department, to wear a surgical mask for all patients with respiratory symptoms. And given that initially we did not have the diagnosis for this patient, we monitored any exposed staff as if they had been exposed to SARS. That was the protocol we used at the time. Taking you forward, January 13th, there are 41 cases reported in Wuhan, 41 confirmed cases. But 700 people are being monitored. There's a suspicion of human-to-human transmission, but not confirmed. There is a case outside of China. The WHO has already released guidelines on management of novel coronavirus infection. So we are starting to look at our preparedness. We are inventorying our PPE and our, as we call them, monkey suits would be the translation, the hazmat suit. January 16th, still 41 confirmed cases, but the concern level is increasing. We're now screening for pneumonia of unknown cause at all of our United Family Hospitals in all of our cities. You can see on the right there our criteria that we were screening for. And at this early stage in the epidemic, in the coming epidemic, we're already transferring patients with these signs to designated treatment hospitals for the Shanghai CDC. There's a separation of care already for suspect patients from other patients to prevent nosocomial spread. January 20th, 282 cases. This is the day that human-to-human spread was unequivocally confirmed. And this was when the case count had been stable for 2 weeks, now suddenly increased. There was a patient who was ill in Shanghai. She had traveled from Wuhan. We're triaging at all of our hospital entrances starting on this day. As you can see, we're meeting people in our anteroom here to make sure patients who are highly suspect don't enter the hospital. And we are sourcing PPE widely for our staff. January 21st, 314 cases. The regional coordination was pretty phenomenal here. We have the Shanghai CDC is directing the workflows at all the public and private hospitals. And there's a strict separation of care for patients suspected of having novel coronavirus or pneumonia of unknown origin with all other patients, both within our hospital and geographically. So our infection control measures are increased. We have a negative pressure room suite with a separate entrance. So patients who were suspects for novel coronavirus, if they had fever and were quite ill, they were transferred immediately. If they were more of a rule out situation, they would enter into our negative pressure room suite. They did not ever contact the other patient population. They had remote checkout. So we could completely separate patients with respiratory symptoms from the rest of our population. We also limited the staff assigned to this area. A family physician was a natural choice since we could see both children and adults with respiratory symptoms. January 22nd, 555 cases. It's now been seen in several countries, including the US. Our hospital leaders are meeting with the Shanghai District Centers for Disease Control. This is our phone triage here on the right. It's pretty extensive. We're looking at history of fever, history of symptoms, cough, fatigue, exposure history, travel to epidemic areas, or contact with people who've traveled to epidemic areas. We're notifying patients over the phone of designated hospitals. So hopefully the most high-risk patients don't ever arrive at hospitals that are taking care of the well patients. January 23rd, this is a watershed moment in the care of this disease. There are generations of human-to-human spread now highly suspected. So on our front, we're limiting hospital visitors. We're postponing routine appointments. We're reviewing our PPE donning and doffing with all of our staff, and we are educating the public. You can see here is a flyer that we sent out to our patients. At this point, we're recommending that patients with cold symptoms, but without a high fever, with no trouble breathing, do not come to the hospital. We want patients to be managing their symptoms at home if they're mild, to limit the burden on our PPE stock. January 23rd, still travel in and out of Wuhan is suspended. The city is on what's called lockdown. So public transportation, trains, airplanes suspended. The WHO did not yet declare a global health emergency, but is watching closely. And this is a list of designated fever clinics we're directing our patients to if they are calling, if they arrive and screen high risk. Of course, if a patient needs stabilization before transport, we would do that. Fortunately, we did not have a high-risk patient present to us as ambulances or phone triage as the whole system was directing the highest risk patients to designated hospitals. January 24th, this is Lunar New Year. So social distancing is actually naturally in place now. Schools are closed for the holiday. This is the most significant event in the year. Businesses are closed, restaurants are closed. Basically, everything is closed except for essential services, even grocery stores typically. Our dress code for all patients now is bare below the elbows. We're not wearing any rings or watches. We're rolling up our sleeves. We're washing scrubs and coats daily. And we are starting to wear surgical masks for all patient contact. We wear masks, patients wear masks, every staff, every visitor, because we're not sure how this disease is transmitted yet. And kudos to our management team who was in the hospital every day, even through the holiday, which is a really profound commitment to keeping us safe. So thank you guys. This is our CMO, Dr. Hao Liu. He's from New York. January 29th, Lunar New Year is being extended. So social distancing measures all across China are taking place. They're very strict in Wuhan, but even in major cities outside of China and small towns, schools we know are not going to resume on time. We didn't know at this point if we would have a surge of patients. So all of our vacation, our CME is canceled, staff are recalled to be ready. We're continuing to postpone non-urgent visits. However, pediatric vaccinations, we are continuing, and we did not have any more influenza vaccination available, but we would have continued in that reducing the disease burden wherever we can is really important. We have standardized PPE across our entire hospital network. February 5th, now 24,000 cases. All non-emergent, non-urgent ear, nose, and throat, dental, ophthalmology, gastroenterology is closed. That's because of the high risk of nosocomial spread suspected if there were aerosolization from dental procedures, presumed heavy exposure from nasal secretions, fecal shedding. You can see on the left there a slide from our hospital in Beijing, patient education about how to keep the home safe and thinking about different zones. For your outerwear and home wear. So that's a helpful thing as well for all of you physicians out there when you're coming home to keep the potential for transmission within the home low. February 7th, 31,000 cases. It's an extended Lunar New Year holiday, which is profound social distancing. We are launching now an internet consultation platform. You can see on the right, this is a test run with one of my colleagues here, Dr. Brian Lee. So no, that was not a patient from Wuhan who was texting me, but the internet consultation platform is designed for triage and is another way to prevent face-to-face contact with patients who may be infectious. To help guide patients who need to either stay home or present to a fever hospital or perhaps have a minor ailment that can be handled without a visit. We're continuing telephone consultations, which is a new service typically in China where most care is indeed handled face-to-face. And we're educating our patients. Online telephone mental health consultations continue, which is a huge service to our community. February 14th, 49,000 worldwide cases. We are continuing to increase our infection control measures as the highly contagious nature of this illness becomes clear. So for inpatient admissions, for planned admissions, we are already discontinuing elective surgery, but for other procedures that are not so elective, The pre-admission screening can, in fact, include a chest CT. We didn't have the option to test for coronavirus at our hospital if we did have a high-risk patient who needed admission but had a suspicious chest CT and CRP. They would be cared for for their current condition in a hospital that was set up to do that. Same for patients in labor. Patients suspected of having coronavirus in labor, we were not delivering at our hospital, but again, we were prepared if a patient presented seriously, presented who was too late to transfer. February 21st, this is a study that Dr. Ahmad referred to. Asymptomatic carrier transmission is documented. Our medical staff, who's been abroad for the New Year holiday, when staff comes back to China, they had 14 days at home before they could return to duty. Initially, this was unmonitored home quarantine, but when I came back on the 20th of March, in fact, I've had a monitored home quarantine that I was just released from yesterday. So we're actively reaching out to our patients. There's some links to some YouTube videos. Thank you to Dr. George, too. I'm very proud of our work together. He and I put together a video on mental health for families and talking to your children about coronavirus. So I hope you find those helpful. March 4th, we continue to be vigilant, even as the number of cases in China is actually really falling by now. There's 93,000 cases worldwide. If you recall, there's the numbers in China only reached the low 80s, so significant growth outside of China. This is our mock emergency C-section drill of a COVID-19 patient who was an actress, of course, door-to-door delivery. So summing it up here, key lessons learned from our experience, infection prevention. We're separating the care of suspect patients and well patients in space and in time. So in space within our hospital, we have a strict isolation between staff who care for patients with respiratory concerns and staff who don't. Initially, that separation, we're directing patients with contact with Wuhan and Hubei to a separate area. But as the scope of the pandemic, as the infectious nature of it became more clear, any patients with rhinorrhea, sore throat, cough, were all seen in our negative pressure rooms and our fever screening clinic wearing full PPE. We're separating care and time. We're postponing those non-emergent visits and well visits. That's to create capacity as well as to prevent nosocomial spread. I want to note, I read on the COVID community, one of the family doctors has been giving vaccinations to children out in their cars. So any way to separate, physically isolate well patients from potential carrier patients is important. Now, as we noted, as Dr. Ahmad noted, asymptomatic spread is possible. If you have adequate surgical masks, I recommend that all physicians, all patients be wearing surgical masks. And a surgical mask won't necessarily prevent you from getting illness from someone who's got high volumes that they're breathing out or aerosolizing, but it will prevent you from spreading it to a patient. And if your patients uniformly are wearing masks, it will protect all of you from asymptomatic spread. If you don't have adequate surgical masks, I know there are a number of people in communities who are really eager to make cloth masks. If you can have cloth masks that you can give to patients and request that they bring back each time they come, fantastic. Of course, reducing those face-to-face visits is vital, and I know the Academy has been working very hard to make that financially possible. With PPE, putting on PPE isn't that challenging. Once you have adequate PPE in your practices, or for those of you who are working in hospitals and emergency rooms, I know that's a lot of you, reviewing how to safely remove PPE is the most important part of using it, because if you don't remove it safely, it really hasn't given you much protection. Creating capacity is another lesson. I know this is happening, delaying non-urgent visits and not doing elective surgeries. We're delaying routine visits. We're just now getting back to that, but continuing vaccinations. and innovation wherever you can. We've seen as the world responds to this, innovation. So mass respiratory casualty in Shanghai, Beijing, we did not fortunately experience this. Ultimately, the number of confirmed cases in Shanghai was in the mid 300s. And that speaks to the profound early and dramatic intervention here in China to prevent the transmission outside of Hubei province. But I want to show that there is work that's been done on this back 2016, 2012, 2008. Those early studies looked more at respiratory casualty and bioterrorism and did not address a nationwide simultaneous event. But studies of pandemic flu have looked at how do you prepare for multiple patients who need respiratory support. So the using a single ventilator to support four patients that's been in the news lately, that's been thought of for several years, as you can see. The pictures here are the screeners. When I returned from the US to China on March 20th, these are tents set up outside. You can see the PPE levels were quite strict. You see a nurse there with gloves on. She is putting on plastic gloves with between every throat swab as well. Those aren't medical plastic gloves, but again, it's being innovative and using what you have. So resource poor areas. When I was reading about strategies for resource poor areas in early January, I honestly hadn't predicted that that would be the US. And it's been really heartbreaking to see how hard people are struggling to get protection. We had adequate PPE, but we were careful stewards of it. Mask use, a surgical mask in clinic with non-high-risk patients, we wear through the day or through the clinic session. The N95 we would wear for 4 hours continuously. And then once removing, we were fortunate not to need to put it back on. Homemade PPE is better than no PPE. I know the Academy is speaking out to let physicians be allowed to wear homemade masks if none others, no surgical masks are provided. We limit staff who see patients with respiratory symptoms. So our family medicine colleagues, you can see children and adults. And so we are ideally suited to be seeing patients with respiratory symptoms. Now, ideally though, we're actually not going to physically face-to-face see patients with symptoms that are mild or moderate. Really, patients should either be home or admitted and not in your clinic if they're suspect COVID or right now, basically any patient with respiratory symptoms. We all want to be good stewards of antibiotics, but if a patient has 4 out of 4 Centaur criteria for strep throat, this may be a time that you treat without testing. Mask reuse, there's a lot of work going on what you can do to how you can safely reuse a mask. You'll see here's a study from early in February on using a hairdryer to make a mask safe again for use. Just note that that mask was placed in a film bag. If you were to use a hairdryer on a contaminated mask, you would simply just blow the virus everywhere. So this was a mask placed in a bag in a lab, and that was a study of whether the virus was still viable. And then the link below at Stanford at the, I can't remember what AIM stands for, but it's a anesthesia and something, but they're looking at exactly this. How do you make a mask safe for reuse? So as the US is preparing for coronavirus now, there are areas that have not been hit as hard yet as New York. You are the most important link to many of your patients for trusted advice. So if you're not yet busy, if you've stopped seeing a lot of the routine care and you're not in the middle of the wave, I recommend you be talking with your community leaders, with your pastors, with school leaders, with elected officials, to be out there and to be advocating for social distancing, for keeping people home. And it's not a popular message. And if you do a really good job of infection control, you will not be thanked. Because if you prevent infection, those are people who maybe never knew they were at risk and never and only felt the pain of the social distancing. But social distancing works. You will be a voice for facts and evidence over rumors and fear. This is me here donating blood at our hospital. So this is one of the most important slides I can show you. You see the little outtake there from January 23rd. So this is the day that Wuhan was locked down. This is numbers of cases in Wuhan. So lockdown is here. And yet the number of diagnoses continued to rise dramatically. And it looked like perhaps it wasn't working. But when you go back, you count back from the diagnoses back to when, in fact, the disease started, either by symptom onset or by estimation from incubation period. Here, January 23rd is lockdown, and you can see right away the number of cases are falling. So expect that diagnoses increase, and from diagnosis, as Dr. Ahmad shared, to respiratory distress, to dyspnea, to respiratory distress syndrome can be a few weeks. So there's a lag time. The infections now we're seeing are an echo of infections of acquired cases a few weeks ago. Innovation and ingenuity. This is in South Korea. They have walkthrough testing. They had drive-through testing early on. These walkthrough testing booths, a patient can enter. There's a no contact area then to collect samples, and they can be cleaned after. So wherever you can think of physical barriers that will separate patients and physicians, that's going to be helpful. So this is from Anderson Cooper yesterday. I thought this is a really hopeful message as well. So we are the descendants of people who have gotten through some terrible things. The collective body of knowledge in medicine, there's good evidence for how we deal with this. And our forebears, both our ancestors and our medical ancestors, have gotten through this before. So these are my colleagues here. And I want my message to be one of hope in a scary situation. In January, we didn't know if this was coming to Shanghai and Beijing. We didn't know if we would look like Wuhan. And it's frightening. So reach out and connect. But the more you can be a leader in your community and a voice for social distancing and for sound information, the better your communities will do. So we got through this. We're doing okay. So I'll turn it over to you, Nina.
Well, thank you, Dr. Jordhen. Looking at the live comments, we have a lot of people commenting. I'm just going to point out a few. From Facebook, Prashant Gupta asks, is it true China is underreporting the amount of cases and the severity of symptoms?
So we can be sure that there are a lot of asymptomatic carriers in any area. And until you have mass screening of a population, you won't know. So whether or not the amount of diagnosed cases was in fact a small sample of the true prevalence, which I think is the case anywhere, you can see that there was swift action based on a small amount of cases. So as you're looking at what to do in the US, if you see 10 cases in your state, 10 confirmed cases, that's the tip of the iceberg. And it's even 4 confirmed cases I saw in one paper is enough to more often than not start community transmission.
Well, thank you. And we also have a comment. It looks like you have fans. Angela Bernard Liu on Facebook said, those of us in Wuhan thank this hospital system for opening up phone consultation for individuals throughout China. And I will wondered if you could actually speak to the phone consultation a little bit more, because I think it would be helpful to the members here, how you set it up, or any barriers you had, or any accomplishments that weren't mentioned on the talk.
Okay, sure. So for our phone consultation, we did not attempt to make it a billable service. So our goals were triage to have patients who had mild symptoms be able to self-manage at home, to direct people to appropriate places for care, and to offer support. So we made that available for people no matter where they were calling from. So for patients in Wuhan, mental health support was really, really important, and we offered that. So it was a stressful time, and we wanted to be there for our community.
Well, it looks like they appreciated it. Rick Metterer from Facebook, sorry if I butchered that name, asks, how long is patient asymptomatic or symptoms considered infectious?
So that's a really good question, and that work is ongoing. I saw one study that showed after resolution of symptoms, half of patients still had virus detectable by PCR, average of 3 days, range 1 to 8. Now, was that virus still infectious? Not sure. But the guidelines recommend returning to work no earlier than 72 hours after resolution of symptoms. But what that testing will look like to ensure somebody is safe and non-contagious, that's developing. But it's a long period with this incubation period, potentially 14 days. We can presume that.
So next we have Crystal Sanchez Dorsey from Facebook. She asked, testing centers that only had surgical masks. If so, were there any differences in healthcare provider infection rates? And I think that's an interesting question.
Yeah, and that's exactly the question I want to know. Unfortunately, that information is not available. I've talked with our infection control nurse, who's talked with the Shanghai CDC. What I don't have is any data to show how many of those infections in Wuhan occurred before people had protection. We do know, say, one of the early cases in Wuhan, this is public information, was a man who presented with abdominal pain and was seen in the surgical ward. And that patient infected 14 healthcare providers because they had no protection. There was a study early on transmission within a family that showed two children who had spent time with an elderly relative in the hospital in Wuhan who was ill. One child did not wear a surgical mask and showed signs of the illness. One child did, just a surgical mask, and one child did not wear a mask and was ill. And the one child did wear a surgical mask and did not show signs of the illness. Nevertheless, I would not presume a surgical mask is adequate. But later in the outbreak, when physicians have had adequate PPE, we certainly haven't seen the infection rate in healthcare providers in Shanghai. And we believe a lot of those infections were early before there was adequate PPE.
Next, Pinnakin Patel on Facebook asks, is 1 meter social distancing enough, or does it need to be at least 2 meters?
Yeah, 2 meters is about the 6 feet. So that's what I'd recommend. And that's why, say, if you are still seeing patients in your office, no matter what reason, even if they're not respiratory illnesses, that if you're both wearing a surgical mask, if you have to come within that 2 meter space, I'd recommend it. And here in Shanghai and basically in all of Asia, we do wear masks when we go out. Now, in Shanghai, cases are low, so we can move about freely, but we are wearing masks. And I think you'll see the U.S. move to that, not as a replacement for social distancing, but in addition, provided that healthcare workers are not deprived by that.
And Priya Shastri from YouTube asks, what are your thoughts about the vaccine?
So I haven't been following, but my hope is that that will be the most important way to control the disease. I expect this will be seasonal. I expect this will become endemic and something that we'll see. Whether or not it will lighten up with warmer weather, I don't know. SARS cleared up in June, but that was intensive public health measures, not just the warm weather. So yeah, I think a vaccine is going to be one of the key pieces of maintaining control of what will be an endemic disease.
Thank you. Lauren Gordon from Facebook, is there any cases of vertical transmission or fetal neonatal effects?
Yeah, so it's not been seen to cross through the placenta as far as we know. Early studies have shown babies who are born healthy, but of course, contact with an ill mother right after delivery. Some babies have shown signs after. SARS, fortunately, was not vertically transmitted, but infection prevention right after delivery is going to be key. I know that ACOG has put out some guidelines on that. So for those of you who do maternity care, this is a time now to be drilling with your staff and going through protocols, walking through protocols of what you will do when you have a baby born to a COVID-19 positive mom.
And I think we'll need more data as it presents itself, and serology will really help to understand what's going on too once we find.
Yep. So that's definitely an emerging area, but I'm optimistic that you won't see a lot of vertical transmission.
Thank you. And then Murad Muhammad Omi is asking, is there genetic or race differences?
I've read that that's been hypothesized, but I haven't seen anything decisive on that. I think now that the disease has come to the U.S. and we're seeing as well very young people in the U.S. getting ill, I don't think we'll see anything meaningful. You know, what we really want to know is what would determine at the onset of the disease that this is going to be a high-risk person, and we don't know that yet. Other than, of course, coexisting conditions, pulmonary disease, heart disease, but other than the obvious ones.
Susan Hill from YouTube asks, for patients who are using homemade cloth masks, what are the recommended techniques for cleaning and disinfecting for reuse? I know you went over a little bit about it, but if you have any additional data or information.
Yeah. So the good news is soap denatures the coronavirus really well. So homemade cloth masks can be washed. So 60 degrees Celsius detergent, that's going to work. And the virus for a non-washable mask, after 72 hours on plastic and steel, viable virus is almost nil. Dr. Ahmad, you showed that slide early on. So this is not based on any studies I've seen, but my interpretation would be, let's say you have a non-washable respirator. If you were to let that sit in a paper bag for 72 hours, the amount of viable virus on that would be low. Whether there'd be a lot of staff on that, not sure. Respirators are not designed for reuse, but let's say a patient shouldn't need a respirator unless they're say a potentially really high risk illness themselves. But if you had three that you could rotate, one every 72 hours, that would likely be better. But again, don't have a lot of evidence on that. So I want to be clear on that.
And just to clarify, I think on your slides, you did have some reference to some data, research articles that were available. Mm-hmm. Do you mind placing it on the member board so that other people can look through it in case they want to try to make decisions on their part?
Yeah, sure. So the research out of Stanford, the AIM out of Stanford, that I saw on the COVID community. So thank you, whoever posted that. it's buried a few days back. And then the other research article I noted is in Chinese, but the abstract's in English. Yeah, if I'm able to post an article on the COVID community, like upload, but we'll figure that out. But yeah, so there's work being done on that.
And Pinakin Patel from Facebook asks, is it possible for COVID-19 test that is negative in the beginning but can turn positive later on?
Absolutely. So Dr. Ahmad, you noted that on one of your studies, the PCR was only about 50% sensitive, whereas the PCR plus IgG or IgM was, IgM was 98% sensitive. So testing regimens here have been multiple tests to assure more reliable testing. For example, to ensure that somebody is clear of coronavirus is minimal PCR times 2 24 hours apart.
And also there's user error. If you don't get enough sample, that also involves getting ending mm-hmm. up having a negative PCR.
Absolutely.
So the next question is from Faiza Fikan from Facebook. Does patient who have infected before is infected in another time or not? I think this question is referring to immunity.
Yeah. And that's just not well known yet. You know, that's what we're hoping, is that infection then will produce reliable immunity, that you'll see antibodies and after infection and know that you won't get it again. And that's obviously how a vaccine's going to work. We would love to know that our healthcare providers who've been infected and recovered can return to the front lines without fear. We just don't know.
And I think it speaks to this being an emerging issue as we're learning from it. Thank you. So Prashant Gupta asks, have Chinese doctors been using Plaquenil with azithromycin during drug regimen to treat COVID patients as outpatient therapy? If so, has it been effective?
Plaquenil with which?
Plaquenil with azithromycin.
I didn't see Plaquenil. I think that azithromycin is mentioned on the national treatment guidelines, but there's no single treatment that's been shown to be widely effective. So a lot of ongoing research. In some of the trials in Wuhan, actually, as the epidemic came under control, they ran out of patients for their trials. So that was a really good side of the strict social control. But I wouldn't say we have enough data yet to say there's a treatment protocol that's going to work widely.
So I'm looking through the questions, and I see you have another fan, Sandra Hans Kelly. She from Facebook says, thank you, Dr. Jordhen, for sharing your firsthand experience. In Greater Cincinnati, we have been encouraging social distancing for a few weeks and have had to stay at home order in Ohio. We're not seeing patients if office, but doing video, phone, and online patient portal visits. We have respiratory clinics and have canceled elective surgeries. Our hospital census is low in anticipation of the surge we expect to come. We still do not have adequate ability to test patients, so we are assuming.
Yeah.
Thank you for the comment.
That is all the right steps. So creating capacity, delaying anything non-urgent, testing is going to help when you can do it. We didn't have it at our hospital, but that's because we were directing patients to a place that did.
Johnny Snyder, Statsiak from Facebook asks, we have converted to all e-visits. Is this being paranoid? I feel like with a 14-day incubation period, it's reasonable. Responsible.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So I talked with one of my colleagues from the UK this week, and they're nearly all telephone e-visits. So that's not being paranoid. Now, there's going to be obviously medical issues that will need a physical exam. You will need auscultation. You will need to evaluate. And some patients will need lab testing. But for right now, if it can be handled non-face-to-face, yes.
Jeff Kane, do you expect future immunity for people who have had COVID-19?
Yeah, so that touches back on that other question. And that, I'd say we just don't know, I hope. But yeah, that's ongoing.
And from Facebook, Aldo DeMalo, is there a correlation between disease severity and prolonged exposure to COVID-19 positive patients?
Yeah, that's presumed. Based on other illnesses, that the viral load makes a difference. So healthcare workers in Wuhan who became ill, there were younger people. There were people in their 20s, early 30s. And it's hypothesized that the intense viral load in that environment may have contributed. And these were people who were exposed early in the epidemic before the high degree of contagion was known. So reducing viral load is absolutely better than doing nothing because an illness may be milder with a lower exposure.
Thank you. I hate to cut the question short. It looks like we're down to our last 5 minutes. So we'll probably have to review some of these questions and answer them later on the member group message board. So we're going to move on to our last topic to go over in conclusion. This is where we would like you all to share your key takeaways from today's sessions in the comments section. This is a P2P activity. And for our next session, next Friday, at 7 to 8 p.m. Central Standard Time, please join us. We're going to have COVID-19 acute care management, an intensivist perspective with Dr. Oscar Estrada, who did have an experience and several experiences in his facility with COVID-19. And so we'll learn from him what occurred there. And as you evaluate this session, be sure to engage with the T2P tool to earn two additional CME credits. More info about T2P will be shared in the COVID-19 community, and the link will be available.
All right. And then I just want to say, before you get through the rest of your presentation, my heart goes out to my colleagues in Madison, Wisconsin, for the loss in your community, in my former community this week. And my heart's with you. And that wasn't from coronavirus. But yeah, I grieving in a time of social distancing is challenging. So love to you guys.
Thank you for that, Dr. Jordhen. And I just wanted to mention again, for anyone who hadn't had their questions answered, we will try to answer those questions later through the member message board. Okay. And I see you have a lot of fans, Dr. Jordhen.
Okay. Well, thank you, everyone, for joining. And I look forward to answering more questions on the message board throughout the weekend and into next week. And as things develop, I'll be watching closely from my side. But we made it through it, guys. You'll get through it.
Thank you, everyone, for joining.